master sleuth Sherlock Holmes has been adopted by many a mystery writer since the last of Conan Doyle's stories was published almost 80 years ago. Now comes another writer, not with a mystery for Holmes to solve, but a novel about Holmes near the end of his life and how he copes with his own failing memory, with regrets about missed opportunities, and with a world grown vastly more complex in the wake of World War II. The novel is A Slight Trick of the Mind. Author Mitch Cullin spoke with us from NPR West last week.
2005, I was going from Los Angeles to other parts of the country, and while at the same time I was trying to write another book, which became Post-War Dream, the book tour was for A Slight Trick of the Mind, and my brain was no longer with A Slight Trick of the Mind. I'd written 6 or 7 books in relative obscurity that were published with much smaller presses, and really I was living very precariously from year to year and from book to book, but I was writing the books I wanted to write, and they were being published with very small presses. I was getting good reviews, and then Slight Trick of the Mind came around. But initially it was a book nobody wanted, and then when my agent got involved, it became a book everybody wanted, and was ultimately picked up by Nantley's Doubleday, which is a division of Random House. I had already had a career's worth of books behind me. Wampajog Branches, Tideland, the short story collection, Undersurface, and then here's A Slight Trick of the Mind, and the game is completely different. It was a very, very distracting to my routine, which had always been finish one book, move on to the next. I also felt obligated to do it, and that was one of the other things that was very different. They had given me all this money for my books, and they had made this incredible leap of faith in me as a writer, so the least I could do, I felt, was go out there and promote the book for them and play the role of writer in the hopes that it would somehow make this thing a very successful book for Nantley's. I got terribly sick during the book tour. This kind of metaphor for my dread, I think, manifested physically into a serious illness. By the time I was in New York, it had become almost like walking pneumonia. I was just ill. So what Random House agreed to do was that wherever I went to an event, there would be another writer, a writer who I liked or I knew or I was comfortable with. I could have a conversation with that writer about the book and about writing. And as it happened in Manhattan at Housing Works, Mary Gateskill agreed to be that writer for me. Mary and I had a past. She was my instructor at the University of Houston. Because she didn't have a car, I became the person who drove her around to the grocery store and the video store. And we became very good friends. For whatever reasons, she trusted me and I trusted her. We got along very well. I was also her house sitter in Houston. So when the time came for this book tour, I asked them to contact Mary to see if she would be the person willing to sit beside me in front of all these people and talk about writing. And she agreed, to my surprise and delight. So in the middle of all this feeling ill and nervous with a lot of trepidation about doing it and not feeling on top of my game, I got to suddenly become reunited with Mary, who I hadn't seen in a number of years. I think perhaps the last time I saw her was maybe 7 years before that, when she came to visit me for Christmas in Tucson. And so we had a nice reunion, and we had a good time together. We both talked about the experiences of losing parents to illness. And in a weird way, her being there made it a lot less intimidating. But it was good seeing her. She was just the same as when we'd spent time together in Houston. That was a highlight for me.
Los Angeles Times, in association with UCLA, presents the Festival of Books. This is celebrating Sherlock Holmes.
I'm Pat Morrison. Our panelists, as you see, are Nicholas Meyer, Leslie Klinger, and Mitch Cullin. One of Mitch's books, Tideland, is being made into a film by Terry Gilliam. Leslie Klinger's 3 volumes, The Annotations of Sherlock Holmes, is just out. And Nicholas Meyer, of course, you know, is the author of The 7% Solution and now The Canary Trainer.
The event at the LA Times Book Festival, I was on a panel, and I was at the height of my illness. I mean, fever, chills, feeling nauseous. So I made a potent cocktail of Sudafed, Dayquil, Tylenol or ibuprofen, several cups of coffee, and then I drove from my side of Los Angeles to the other side of Los Angeles to UCLA. But before the event, I was taken to the green room and I was seated at a table where I was told I would be called when it was time to go on stage. And seated to my left is John Dean from the Watergate days. And to my right is Michael York. They were also at the book festival promoting books. And I'm drugged out of my brains having a conversation with both these gentlemen. But to be honest with you, the whole thing is out of my mind. I cannot remember a thing.
Hello and welcome to Books in Review. I'm Susan Petty. Today we're talking to Mitch Cullin, author of A Slight Trick of the Mind, a novel, well, let's see, how shall I describe this? A novel of Sherlock Holmes in Hiroshima, a novel of Sherlock Holmes in retirement as a beekeeper, and Sherlock Holmes' own transcription of a case that was puzzling to him. Welcome, Mitch. We're so glad to have you.
Thank you for having me.
Dallas, out of all the stops, was particularly unusual for me. I did a lot of press in Dallas. I think the spin was local boy makes good kind of thing, even though I had spent very little of my life in Dallas. Dallas was a homecoming of sorts. I had been there the year before to say goodbye to my mom, who passed away on Christmas Eve of ovarian cancer at her home. My oldest sister, Charisse, lived near Dallas in Denton. My father was in Denton as well. I had family there. My oldest sister, Charisse, had been so influential on me growing up in terms of reading and writing. She was my homeroom English teacher for 2 years in high school. I thought it would be a good opportunity for her to be the person who sits down with me and talks about writing. I asked Charisse if she would like to do it, and she agreed. So that was a real highlight. I got to sit down with my oldest sister, and my stepsister Amy was there with her children. My Aunt Carol was there. So it was really good to see all those people.
We've been speaking with Mitch Cullin. His new novel is A Slight Trick of the Mind. And with Lori R. King, her new novel forthcoming is Locked Rooms. Thank you very much, Mitch and Lori.
Thank you, Rick.
Tell me, what is the eternal appeal of the character of Sherlock Holmes? Let's start with you, Mitch.
Oh, boy. I'm not sure I've figured that one out myself. I'm shocked by it. I suppose when I started even writing this book, I wasn't even sure if there was an appeal for him anymore. But I think it has something to do with the fact that he was created as this kind of ultimate rationalist. And I think, especially in a world that at times feels increasingly irrational and strange, that he seems like kind of an oasis of reason.
Lori.
I beg to differ. I would say that the appeal is the fact that despite his rationality, he is also intensely emotional. And it's very interesting in the Conan Doyle stories, the sparsity with which you find these emotional outbursts, but how illuminating they are when they come.
The Bay Area comes up. I was visiting multiple bookstores with Tom Barbash, Lori King. A very interesting experience for me because Lori is this kind of personality. She had written The Beekeeper's Apprentice, which was about the wife of Sherlock Holmes, an elderly Sherlock Holmes with a much younger wife. In meeting Lori, what we came to realize is that she had been the much younger wife of a much older man who was her professor. She couldn't have been more generous to me when I was with her in Santa Cruz. She gave me a tour of the area. She has a rabid cult following of people who adore her work. Doubleday thought that her readership might jump on board Slight Trick of the Mind. So I was paired with her. She was gracious enough not to let me kind of sit in the background, so that was nice. And I'm awkward in those kind of things, but in that regard, she seemed to know what to do. She kind of stepped in there and did most of the talking, and I was fine to kind of sit back and let her do that. The other writer I was paired with was Tom Barbash. Tom was more of the kind of writer that I felt akin to. Our writing is very different. He's written nonfiction, among other things, but a literary writer nevertheless. And he was in some sense the antithesis of what Lori King was. He was less of a personality there to kind of prop me up, and more of someone I felt was an equal that I could sit there with and and kind of have a good back and forth about writing and what it was to be a writer in this time. And Tom's just a genuinely nice, intelligent man.
At some point during my time in the Bay Area, the idea of doing a book tour didn't seem so bad. I found that I didn't mind it so much. I suddenly realized I was enjoying the fact that I was being driven around and taken from place to place where people seemed genuinely interested and excited to meet me. It was good to just talk to people about writing, talk to people about my books, and enjoy playing the role of a writer for once. And then, just as quickly as it had started, the whole thing ended.
So what's next for you?
I think at some point, relatively soon, I'll sit down and start to work on another book. But these things take longer to do. When I was younger, I could do it in 9 months. It's getting longer, a little harder. But also, it's trying to find a middle ground between being a full-time writer and being a full-time human being that has a life beyond writing. And I've been trying to learn how to navigate that with varying degrees of success. But I'm getting there, so we'll see.